Ladies and gentlemen, it's 10,000 Maniacs!
Like, what was it like 5 years ago? What
at the Franklin? You were there. You know what it was like. It was dirty kid fun, in a way. It was sneaking down to the Beehive when I was 16 to sing through really horrible equipment to usually hostile crowds, but half hostile and half indifferent, in a way.
Originally, the band was basically a cover band and had a horn player, a different guitar player, another woman playing keyboards besides Dennis. But that only lasted for about the original 4 or 5 months of the 10,000 Maniacs. And then I joined, and the guitar player, the horn player, and the other keyboard player went and searched for a drummer for a year or so and came up with Jerry.
The other band I was in was a basic three-piece garage rock band, and the bands prior to that were all pretty much rock orientated. I've only been in one other band besides the one before, the Maniacs, which did original material. Everything else was cover bands, and you know, the hits of Billy Squire and the Led Zeppelin and things like that. But you know, that stuff all helped me. You know, I've sort of touched on a lot of styles. I played a little, attempted to play some jazz and rhythm and blues in college, and I think it's broadened my base. But no, this band was quite unique as far as their musical style, and I just kept doing what I was doing, and you know, it fit right in.
It's just like a day-to-day thing. I feel successful when we get to play a gig, and then when we're in here in the palace writing songs, and if we come up with an idea that everyone's pretty happy about, that's a great success, you know, to me. And we've never really had, I never really set long-term goals. When we started 6 years ago, never in my wildest imagination did I believe that we would play to 1,200 people at the College Stadium, or that we would sell 50,000 records. You know, I just never thought that we would reach that level. It was just
coast to coast live TV.
Sure, or play in Europe. I just thought, wow, that's, you know, instead of playing down here at the Hotel Franklin, let's see if we can get a gig at the Rusty Nail. And then from there it was like Buffalo and then Rochester. And then as we expanded, you know, we began to see, you know, what might be over the horizon. And it's given us enough courage and desire to keep going, although at the very slow maniac pace that we work at. You know, it's still happening, you know, just something like the College Stadium thing was pretty thrilling for me. I had a wonderful time, and I was so pleased to see all the kids come out and see us and that they enjoyed it.
Yeah, they certainly did that.
And, you know, it's really encouraging because I never felt that it was going to be a relatively easy thing to reach teenagers. It's been difficult because they can't go to the clubs to see, and we didn't have a video on MTV up until a few months ago.
Thank you.
There is rain, and we do risk our lives if it rains too much. So if we have to cut it short, you forgive us. Yes.
Scorpio.
Yeah.
went to London to try and make a very modern record, because we've all been fans of British pop music. And the way mixing and recording has been going over the last couple of years is to make the records very bright, very clean. We're a clean band to begin with. We don't use any distortion, well, occasionally distortion. But where a lot of bands, you know, like that garage sound, we have a different sound, and it is a clean sound. So some people might think that it's a little too bright, but we're pretty happy with it.
Well, we recorded the Wishing Chair in London with Joe Boyd, and the record company set us up with a house and VCR and television stereo and car. Make it as comfortable and as much like home as possible. And the studio itself was a little tiny place. It was in a church called Livingston Studios in
Wood Green.
And it was our first opportunity to spend any, you know, more than just a day or two in a professional studio with the SSL computer-controlled board, a lot of stuff that I don't know about. And it was really, it was thrilling at first, and then after the second or third month, it started to get a little like, when is this gonna end? We've been mixing and remixing and mixing and remixing for so long, which is what really took up most of the time. You know, you go and you lay down your basic tracks, and then you do your overdubs, and then it's like, as we would mix a song, or we'd get on to the next song or the third song, the mixes got better, so we'd go back and redo songs that we had previously done, and then go through everything, and then the mixes would get even better. I don't know, it's hard to describe, but it's just sort of this feeling or that you get out of the mix when you're listening to it, and it, you know, like, hits me in my stomach or, you know, or in my heart or something like that. And you just look for that magical moment within the mix.
Intuition.
We'll be right back. Thank you. birthday.
We'd like to thank Harry Nettie, the city of Jamestown, Allison Blue, and Howie Feldman and the Steel Appeal Band, and all of you for coming down. We really appreciate it.
And my mom and my dad and the Westfield Sharks. This is the encore. There we go.
Brian, you know.
Close.
capital, Washington, D.C.
There's more room for growth and development on our part. As far as popularity, I don't believe we've peaked.
Yeah, not even close. Hardly anyone in America actually knows who we are, even though that's hard to believe because we have a video on MTV. They only play it at 3 in the morning, so. And no, people really don't know who we are in America at all. We're more well known in Europe still. So we have a long ways to go in this country. We're just starting out.